You know, that's a big deal with me. Like, when I get in the zone, and when I just make the song, I try not to just, I don't want to go back and fuck with it in any kind of way, because it's an in the moment type thing with me. I don't sit there and think about it too long. I literally make myself not think so the words can flow out of my head.
And we're on. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. If you're listening or watching, you're now tuned in to I Don't Know That's Perfect, the most professional, unprofessional podcast out of South Austin. I'm your host, Mario from the South Side. And today I am posted up by myself chilling because Nick is on vacation. Shout out, Nick. Enjoy yourself out in San Fran, I believe where he's at. But either way, we're still moving. And today we have a special episode for y'all because I am joined by none other, Mr. DoWrong, Lil Bully from the league. What's up, bro? How you doing?
Man, I'm good, bro. I'm getting there. All the goals, I'm trying to meet them, man.
Thank you for coming out. And I know we had a for those that will stay tuned, we'll have a little this is Texas event coming out soon that we did a while back. But this is an episode that it's been long overdue because I've been trying to have you. I've been trying to have the whole league, honestly, on the show.
And man, that'll be a feat, bro. I can't even get the league.
Yeah, I know. Like, everybody's already doing their own thing.
All across the country and shit now, bro.
It's a beautiful thing, though.
Yeah, man.
But for those that are unfamiliar, go ahead and introduce yourself. Let the people know who you are, bro.
DoWrong, Lil Bully, the youngest member of the league. Man, I'm the youngest nigga running shit right now. You know what I'm saying? I got this shit on lock, bro. I don't really feel like it's too many people that's seeing me when it comes to this shit, man. You got to be like that, though. A lot of people out here, they don't really like too much competition, but I always been like that, man. I need the competition, man. I'm looking at the Y2s and Joneses and how I'm gonna compete with that. You can't be laid back playing around and shit, man. You got to be on top of it.
Yeah, and I definitely fuck with your style out because like I've told you before, your style's more like in the face, raw, gritty, and just like straight to the specs. It's fucking what is it, Stack of Starve.
Yeah.
And it's like real life shit. Yeah. You can preach about shit, but you don't really go tell it how it is. So
appreciate you, man. Appreciate
I understand. You're from North Austin, right?
Yes, sir.
What part exactly are you from?
Rumburg. I went to Graham Elementary and shit. I really grew up off Breaker and shit in Walnut Ridge and shit. That's where I grew up and shit.
Okay, I feel that. So is that something, because I know from my understanding, your background and how you were introduced to the music was because of ESBE, RIP ESBE, 6'3 Bully.
ESBE, man.
Were you doing music before you got involved with him and the league and everybody? Or
me doing music before I got involved with the league was mainly to impress my uncle.
Okay, to just get his attention.
Yeah, because that was my best friend.
Okay.
Because my father passed away when I was 15, turning 16.
Okay.
And I kind of like leaned on my uncle and him just being the genuine person that he was and just real. There just ain't no question. It's my nephew. He'll come on, and he just so
Took
happened
you under
to be
his wing.
He just so happened to be doing the music, and he had the league shit going on. They had already been going on tour.
Yeah.
I'm already at school bragging to all my friends. My uncle's on tour right
family.
Now.
That's my family.
Yeah.
I feel that.
I had the whole school on him, man.
Shit.
And long story short, I was showing him my music, and he took me to the studio with him one day, and shit, the rest is history. It was me, him, and Grizzo, and Tuck the Gat in the studio, man. Man, what's up, Tuck? What's up, bro? I ain't talked to you in a minute, bro. I love you, fam. Just holler at me, bro. What's up, Grizzo? What's up, Jay? What's up? And I love y'all, bro. What's up, Doc?
The whole family.
Man, but long story short, man, it was just nothing. We did the song, and I was on the League Volume 3. The League shit Volume 3, that was my first tape with the League. And then after that, we did the plug, and it was just history after that.
Were you ever on tour with them whenever they were roaming around?
Yeah, I went on the Ritz tour.
Okay.
Anything after the Ritz tour, anything you heard about the league doing after the Ritz tour, during the Ritz tour, I was there.
Yeah.
I was the mascot for a long time,
you know,
too.
And I was going to ask that, like, were you wearing the fit? I remember whenever you were starting to get introduced, because I didn't catch on to the league a little too early, because I was like 15, 16 at the time, but once I started seeing like their movement and shit, and I saw that they had like the mascot out of shows, and I saw you were being introduced, because I was like, man, like, I wonder if that's some sort of initiation or whatever.
It literally was my initiation, because he wouldn't let me rap on stage for a long time.
Okay,
so like, and I really appreciate that shit too, because it gave me my stage presence. It made me fearless on stage.
It made you comfortable.
I never went through the stage fright stays because I was already on stage and I seen what it was like to be in a mascot on stage.
Okay.
And I went on a whole nationwide tour and they let me rap.
From
I was
crowds
after every show I take the mask off. And this is what made me like that though, because I'd be on stage and the whole time I really wanted to rap. So I have this fucking mascot on, and I'm going ham for my uncle. Like, I don't care. Yeah. This is my uncle. He need me to put this shit on. I'm trying to put this shit on because I get to go with these dudes while they on tour and shit. I don't give a fuck what nobody say. I done seen the world because I put that shit
hell
on.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So I love that shit, man, because I wanted to rap the whole time. And when it was finally my time to rap, I'm like, hey, man, look. Hey, I'm walking up to my uncle. The first show I did was in Houston. He took me to Houston to work at the warehouse, and it was live as fuck. It was a Splitterillo show. It was like 1,000 people in that bitch, bro.
Shit.
It was live as fuck. And I remember we were on stage, and I walked up to him. I was like, hey, can I rap? Hey, man, you gonna let me rap? Let me rap. I got something for him. He didn't even know I had something. I was like, let me rap. And I took the man, he walked up, he was like, hey, y'all want me to let my nephew rap? My nephew, and they start going crazy.
Shit.
They was like, ah. I took the mascot off and spit something, and my uncle was like.
He's like, oh, he got bars. He got bars.
He wasn't ready, bro. Ever since then, it was history, bro. I fell in love with that shit. I took that mask off, and it was nothing.
Just
fell right in place. So all the scary, stay frightened, the scary feelings and shit, I never felt none of that because I wanted it so bad.
So it definitely made it a lot easier for you to be around and be in large crowds, especially when you're performing, because I would imagine it's like one of those things where it's like, people tell you to just pretend you're in your underwear staring at people out there or whatever. So I would imagine some sort of equivalent.
No, really, really would turn me out, dog. We did a show in L.A. at, I think it was a Viper Room. It's like, I think that's Johnny Depp's club or some shit. It's a historical club in L.A. So I was on stage with the mascot, and Lil J used to pump the shit out of my head. Anytime we on tour, we go anywhere, Lil J pump my head up. I'm the crash dummy on tour, bro. Don't tell me to
just
do nothing.
Shit.
I'm just finna do something. I don't care, bro. So many stories I wouldn't even. It's some stories I ain't finna tell on this motherfucking podcast. And Lil J pump my head up. He know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm saying? So, man, it was just, he told me to get into the crowd. Some thick ass girls in the crowd, man. I'm like 17, man, turning 18
shit.
So that's young bully, bro. I was wild as hell, bro. I'm jumping in the crowd. The girl starts twerking on me because I had the mascot on. And I was like, it just blew my mind that you can have that much power inside of a mascot. Just
for real.
Period. Not
didn't
even just
know who you are.
Just being on stage, period. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That shit was crazy, dog. And I just wanted that shit.
Yeah, it definitely is an amazing feeling to be out on stage and definitely be rocking with people, because I've had some of a similar situation out at some point whenever we had it was a Keith Corona. Shout out Keith.
Shout out Keith Corona.
He brought me out one time. He saw I was down and out or whatever. He hit me up. He brought me out to one of the first times that Freddie Gibbs came out to the Empire.
I was there.
I think that's the first time I met you.
I was there.
And he brought me out to the back, to the green room. And
everybody
was supposed to
be that little circle.
The
little circle table in the back. No, that night was crazy to me, dog, because fucking D Madness was in there. You know, D, remember?
Yeah.
But he was back there, and you know, he was blind. And somebody, I feel like, in my memory, somebody was talking shit, and he threw a ball at them, or like a ball of water paper in my memory. And it's just like tripped me out because he's fucking blind. It's like some daredevil shit.
He's a dope player for sure. Yeah.
He's always been the dopest to me because how the fuck are you playing this shit? You're blind.
Exactly. Yeah. I definitely remember that. And that's the night also too. They had the VIP had like a large ass cooler with a bunch of fucking Jameson whiskey and shit. And I was out there with Surdy too because they were performing and shit. He brought me out on stage. I was just hype as hell, just getting crunk with the crowd. They didn't even know who the fuck I was and shit, you know. But it definitely is an amazing feeling to be able to be out in the crowd and the crowd feeling you just because who you rocking with and shit.
Yes,
you know?
Sir.
But going after that, cause how long ago was that now at this point? Whenever you got to go on tour with the league, cause I know
that was almost ten years ago.
I would say no.
That was almost 10 years ago. Yep, 9 years because it's 2012, 2021. Man.
And so I guess after that, and obviously after everything happened, and
man, I went through a lot after that. Man, my uncle had passed away. We went to A3C. And I came back 2 weeks after that, and he ended up passing away in front of the emergency room. And it really fucked with my heart because he passed away in front of the emergency room. So, like, I had to deal. I was going through a lot of that. I was grieving. I didn't know how to grieve. I didn't know how to.
Yeah, nobody ever really knows. Yeah,
there's no fucking rule book on this shit, man. Ain't no guidelines, man. You just get through it how you get through it. You know what I'm saying? And I had to get through it how I got. I ain't even gonna lie. I'm really just now getting to the point to where I feel like I'm healthy in my mindset and in my mental.
Yeah.
To where I can talk about this shit and actually have some insight on how to grow and how to get and how to not. I don't like when people say get over it, because there's no way to get over having a loss like that, especially if it's real, real close to you. There's no way to get over having a loss like that.
It has to fuck you up some sort of way, and there's no way.
Yeah, man, it's supposed to change you, because if you still go through your life and you stay the same after that shit, and it's you have to be insane to stay the same like that, because that dramatic of a change in your life and you still doing the same shit after that, I feel like maybe it's a way for some people to grieve, but overall, it's unhealthy. You're not supposed to do that.
Yeah, it's one of those things that's unfortunate. It is a part of life, and I've heard it so many times. Like, as you get older, it happens. But still, like, nobody ever talks about how to prepare for it or how to even act out or how to adapt to it. Because if we're being real right now, you can't get over it. You do have to adapt.
Supposed to learn to live with it.
Exactly,
You don't get over it. You never get over it, because you getting over it, I feel to me, is forgetting about your people.
Yeah, and like you not never thinking about it, no.
You never want to forget about it. And the more you don't think about it, it's gonna hurt you more.
Yeah.
The mental health is a real thing, and especially in hip hop, the people don't talk about it in hip hop. There's a stigma in the urban demographic with mental health.
To not show your emotions or hide your shit.
Especially in being a man in the urban demographic, because it's not even about being black no more, man. There's still a stigma on being black. Regardless, I wouldn't give a damn what nobody says, but it's not about being black no more, because, man, you see what they did to the Asians, but there's a double negative on that too, man. So we can talk about that all day too, man. Because the way the government is set up and everything that's going on, black people been getting oppressed for 400 years.
The shitty end of it. So you got brought out from, you got taken away from your home, and a lot of people nowadays don't even know how far back their ancestry goes. Which
the Asians
is
been getting hated against for two, and y'all wrote a bill in the government about this shit, and y'all ain't did nothing for the black people, man.
Yeah, it's.
That shit don't make sense to me, man. It is what it is, because you know the history of the country, but can't really speak too much on that, because they try to take the history away from you. They don't even want you to know where you came from.
Exactly.
They don't even want you to know the truth, man.
And they just passed Greg Abbott's fucking dumbass just passed a bill talking about how they can't really discuss current events and racism. Yeah, I was like, how does that make sense?
And this don't even have nothing to do with music, man. This shit just some real serious shit that's been on my heart, man. Like, this shit is crazy right now, bro. Like, how can y'all do that to these kids?
Exactly. Like,
and it's like, it makes it even more on the urban demographic. If you have kids or if you have any youngsters up under you, they need the guidance. If you have the knowledge and you're not giving it to them, you're not an OG.
Yeah, just teach. Yeah. It's like, it's rare that you do have that one history teacher, that one teacher in general, that will be like, tell you the truth and be like, fuck it, like, this is what the textbook is saying, but I'm going to tell you like it is. Like, this happened, and this is what they didn't tell y'all. And, you know, and they're trying to stray away from that shit. And it's unfortunate, because I understand it's Texas, but fuck, man. Like,
it's shit that motherfuckers don't be talking about. That's really why I brought it up, man, so we could speak on it and touch on it, because motherfuckers don't be talking about this shit, man. They don't want people to provoke thought. They want people to just be zombies, man. They don't want this shit to blow up, man. That's why they convicted old boy.
Yeah, and it definitely is a harsh truth, but I mean, this is why we're here, and this is why we talk about what we talk. On the last episode, I had a homegirl who got on a call with us, and she works at I forget what exactly she does, but she works on downtown at the Capitol and does a lot of stuff for the bills, and they were doing during the Texas Legislature, working nonstop, trying to like fight the bills and pass the good bills, and it sounded like a fucking stressful fucking day or like week for her, because I was like, man, the shit that they're trying to like. I'd be out there trying to fight people if I was in that situation, which I'm glad I'm not. You know, I couldn't handle that.
You wouldn't last that long.
No, hell no.
They like people like you up in there. They gonna
turn my ass right away. Quick.
Hell yeah. They gonna get you right on up out of there. They gonna make it to where you can't even come back. That's the type of. And it's crazy because you ain't nothing but passionate about it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But on another note, man, you gotta speak on. The real, man. I just had to touch the topic, man.
And as always, just stay informed, vote local, and just try to keep up with everything that's going on in your city and your local and state. You know, that's all that matters at the end of the day. Like,
fight the good fight, you know?
That's what Austin needs a lot more of, more artists and more people with a little bit more of a popular demand speaking on things like this. We don't have too much of that.
No, yeah, I mean, that, like I said, like I keep saying, like, that's what we're here for. It's not even, I'm not trying to be on all like, I want everybody to know who I am or hear what I talk about. It's like the people I have on, you know, there's some fucking interesting, very talented people in the city that we have. And here you go, I got you. And, you know, that's what we're here for. You know, the more attention we get, the more attention people get, you know, vice versa. It's a win-win. There's never going to be a situation where I'm like going to cut out anybody or try to push anybody out, because anybody here that comes on our show and talks their truth, that's what we're here for. That's what we're here to promote and elevate, and as far as the scene goes, you know.
Yes, sir.
But like, also going back to ESBE, your uncle, after the unfortunate passing, it did come some good that came after that, because it was something to do because of his health was the
man,
main
cause. Shouts out to the artist that painted the mural, man. You don't even know what that meant to me. I don't even know your name, brother. But I just gotta say, man, you don't even know what that meant to me through my healing process, man. I really, 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 man, I wanna hug you, bro. I don't even care, bro. I will kiss your fucking face, bro. You don't even understand what that meant to me, man. That shit is so serious, bro.
That's love. That was for sure. It's one of those things that really started acknowledging, and, like, what was going on as far as, like, the city recognizing the local talent and the meaning behind the people that are actually here, instead of like just disregarding this another black man passing away.
Yes,
you know?
And the thing was with his death, man, it was, he didn't have insurance.
Yeah.
So that's
it
why.
It brought awareness to it too.
Yes. The Austin music, what is it called?
Ham?
Ham.
Yeah.
Yes, man. I appreciate y'all. I don't know if y'all like really, really started up because of that. But in my perspective, I started seeing they had more of a presence after the bully's passing.
Yeah.
And it really hit a close place to home, because it was so unexpected to me. Like, he had a pulmonary embolism, and for two tours, basically, he was on tour sick, and he was still rapping and doing what he loved, because no matter what, he was going to do what he loved.
Yeah.
And he got home, and he was still a little sick. We did the Atlanta show. I was on stage with him while he was sick. Mm. He could barely fucking breathe, and he's on stage fucking rapping his heart out, literally. Like, it was the craziest thing to me, and now that I'm, you know what I'm saying, I'm getting on the other side of grieving and stuff like that, you know what I'm saying? I'm forever going to grieve over my peoples, but it's just like, now I can have a little bit more of a clear-minded perspective when I'm looking back at the scenario and looking back at the, you know what I'm saying, the little pinpoints and stuff like that. You know what I'm saying, the stuff that I didn't really think that much of when it was really going on.
I mean, at the same time, we didn't know any better.
Yeah,
nobody ever like really told you, like, especially as an artist, like, coming from the city that it's known as the live music capital of the world, but specifically it's catered to rock bands, country bands, and shit like that. It kind of doesn't. It's not made as aware to us, but
yeah,
it sucks that it had to go that far for it to be more like shown to us.
Recognized, yeah, man.
Yeah,
and he laid his life down for this shit, man. That's why I'm never gonna stop, man. It's go hard or go home till I die, man. It's because shit.
And I will tell you, ESBE is the reason that I got introduced to the league, because I don't know what I was doing. One day I was just browsing through YouTube, looking up shit for Austin. You know, like, I was just being like an Austin fanatic, like trying to find people from Austin and shit. And I found a video of ESBE on YouTube. He was going on some sort of rant or whatever.
He was sitting on the couch.
Yeah, he just got us a rant and shit.
Oh, man.
And I was like, oh shit, what's this? And it kind of led me to the music. And I was like, oh shit, he can rap.
The crazy part about that shit is that's the internet right now. Like, all the content creators and shit like that, that's all the shit that they're doing. They're just doing reactions to videos or whatever they can do a reaction to, it's on there. And it's crazy as fuck, because that was just like the start to for my site, that was the start of the fucking reaction era, because that shit is funny as hell, dog.
Yeah, he's such a character for sure.
Yeah, bro.
He'll
never be another, man. I swear, man.
Rest in peace, ESBE, the Sixth Street Bully. And that name too. That name alone is just,
man, it's iconic, man. This is if you from Austin, and you don't know who SB the Sixth Street Bully is, man, you need to do your research, man.
Yeah.
You need to go back and look and listen to this shit, man, because this shit is retarded, bro. I don't know what the fuck he was thinking while he was writing this shit and rapping, man, but this shit don't make no sense, bro. Still to this day, I feel like, man, I wish, like, damn, man, I wish he can tell me something. This man, look, this man wrote a verse in 10 minutes. I watched him write it. Dude wrote a hook in three verses, bro. He was talking to himself the first two verses. The third verse, he talked as God responding to his prayers in the third verse. It's the throatiest shit I ever fucking heard.
Yeah.
The dude had the most vivid vocabulary when it came to telling these stories, bro. Like, I could never, I strive to tell stories like this. I have one song where I, like, really, really got in my bag, and it's one of the old leak tapes. It's called, what's that story, bro? Where I was, I got a bullet with your name on the fucking tip, so close your eyes as I stick this Glock between your lips. Man, what's the name of that song?
He's like,
bro,
I would come with it.
I can't think of the name. My brother gonna come with it.
In the meantime, do you mind if I play something real quick, yes, Bully? Like some I want to play some. I'm sure you're familiar with this, and everybody should be Bully Basics.
Man, dog. Man, you know what? That's a hard song. What's the name of that song? What's the name of someone was talking about yesterday? How's my life? I can't complain. It ain't kosher. I don't need a 4-5 strapped in my holster when I'm out. Ain't no looking over my shoulder. I'm 27 with no enemies. The beef been over. Barely keeping up for something to keep us from top ramen. Hit a nigga for a brick or two is what I've been thinking. Man, rest in peace, Uncle. I love you, dog. That shit crazy, bro.
Man.
Yeah, much man. Love. Bully Basics to the death, man. On me, bro. Little bully shit.
I love this song. Shout out rapper Rick. Yeah. Concealed weapons volume 3, nigga. What the fuck you thought it was? Yeah. And this is being brought to you specially by the Bullet, bitch. Well, let me welcome you niggas to Bully Basics. Old flow like a shoe joint, jukebox playing. You nuts, so on the rooftop, ballin' with Tommy Shepard for boost. If you think the league ain't about to cop and recoup, refusing tracks like I'm rapping steroids, or it's weights in the booth. Either way, I'm heavy to digest, like eating a shoe. And I'm proof that God look at the kids and imbeciles too. How else do you explain I'ma fuck over rap like I do? And the fact that I'm actually one of the ones you said that wouldn't amount to shit, let you tell it. I should have been the first amongst the gold, but long as I can blow, I'ma make it no matter what. Because for some reason, my problem disappears. Been with every Dutch. Feel like I'm one of the greatest niggas never to be discovered. The field's full, but I'm fueled by the fury of my brothers. And my fucking Fahrenheit is peaking at triple numbers in December. So I know it's gonna be a hell of a summer. Bully Basics. SB, Bully, rest in peace.
And for those that don't know, SB, it wasn't SB. It was ESBE, Entering Soldier Boys Era.
Oh, shit. Wow.
Yes, sir.
Maz was definitely ahead of his time.
Number boy was on some shit, man.
That is wild.
The real soldier boy.
Yeah.
Man, the people don't know that's what SB stood for, man. I love to be the one to tell that story, man, because that man was a legend, man. That's all Fat Pat, man. If you need to get up on that, you really love your city, man, you need to know who the Bully is, man, because this man opened a lot of doors, and I'm grateful and I'm happy to be able to call this man my uncle and my role model, man, because it ain't going to never be another, man. I know it. That era is over. We already into the next era for the city, man. It's time for me to represent, man.
Yes,
so
sir.
I got some shit ready for y'all. Y'all just stay tuned. I appreciate y'all. I appreciate the love. Anybody been fucking with me this whole time? Just I got you. Don't even worry about it, man. I got you. Don't even worry about it.
And that's what I love about it, because you definitely are like the next generation. As far as the league goes, but not only that, your family, you know, as far as the Bully legacy goes, because at this point, both of y'all have had a front cover at the Austin Chronicle.
We're the first two to have a
front
cover. He's the first one, I'm the second, and I'm happy to be able to say that, man, because it's so amazing to me, man, because none of this shit in my life, I know for a fact, man. None of the positive shit that I have going on. Of course, later on, I start moving and making my own positive moves and stuff. But from the beginning, a lot of the shit that I had going on would not be possible without my uncle, man. Because he just put me in the right place at the right time. And it's so amazing to me because he was already gone.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I'm still looking over you.
I met so many people, man, you wouldn't even believe half the stories, man. I done met Malice from clips of One Fuck with Pusha T, man. I done met DMX. One time, that's crazy. Look, we were sitting in front of, I think it's called the Burger Bar. We inside the Burger Bar, and I'm sitting there eating my burger, slamming. I forgot who was sitting there. I think it was Low Key that was sitting next to me. He's like, look, there go Cal Drogo. I'm like, what the fuck, Cal Drogo? Oh my God, what? I fanned the fuck out, bro. I brung up my mama, me and my mama watching the show and everything. I fanned out, I couldn't help it, bro. So we outside the same bar, and we sitting there chilling, and this fool DMX just pulls up in a fucking excursion.
Oh shit!
And parks halfway on the curb and on the street, and he's like, "Y'all got any blunts?" I was like, "What the fuck? This nigga asking us for blunts right now? What the fuck? This shit is crazy, bro."
Shit.
I met Gangsta Boo. Gangsta Boo was cool as hell, man. The cool. Okay, since we going on stories, I done went on a tandem. I'm just going ahead and say, Devin the Dude is the coolest fucking rapper on earth. I don't give a fuck what nobody say.
I agree.
This fool Devin the Dude was the coolest person I've ever met in my life. Even in a regular sense, not even nothing with to do with a show. This dude cool as hell, bro. He's the most genuine.
That's
person.
All he raps. It's like,
man,
just like how he raps.
He's exactly like how he raps. In Zero too. Zero exactly. Don't never go try to meet Zero.
He ain't gonna have that shit.
You gonna be sick, bro. You gonna break your heart, bro. What made me say that about Devin, though, was we did a show in Alabama, and the crazy part to me was Alabama and Texas was playing that year, and I was watching the show. We were in the garage. The dudes that did the show were the Cold Boys. Shout out to the Cold Boys. What's up, Alabama? And they were cooking for us, man. Like, it was some real wholesome shit, man. They were cooking for us. The food was good as hell.
Yeah.
Man, the grandma cooked up some good-ass bar. Man, that shit was good in the mug. Boy, I never forget that shit. It was like 10 years ago. I still remember that shit, man. And we in there smoking, watching the game, man, and I'm passing a blunt the whole night behind me. But I'm not paying attention.
You're just going back and forth.
I'm so high, somebody keep grabbing the blunt. I ain't even thinking about it. And then I grew up listening to Devin. It was one of my dad's favorite rappers. You know what I'm saying? And I'm sitting there chilling, and I hear the laugh. I'm like, what? We got a show with Devin tonight. Who the fuck is? Oh, I've been passing the blunt to Devin all night. I didn't even know he was the one grabbing the blunt. When we get to the show, and this I always think about this because this is another reason I fell in love with music. This goes along with it, man. We were in the show in Birmingham, man, and that night I almost got into it with somebody, but didn't nobody see.
Okay.
I'm like 17, fam, and we out of pocket, bro. So I was like, I didn't want to go tell them because I already knew what it was because you know how Lil J and them is. They for real deal Holyfield.
Yeah.
They not playing no games.
You'd have everybody mobbing.
Yeah, like, everybody finna mob, fam. So I really was like, man, I ain't even finna say nothing to it. Yeah, we finna just do this show, you know what I'm saying? And the whole rest of the night, I could feel the tension, you know what I'm saying? It was like, you can cut that shit with a butter knife. It was that thick up in there, like. And I stood next to Devin, and I was like, man, I just can't hold it in, man. Like, bro, my dad used to listen to you every day, man. I used to listen to you all the time. We used to ride around with the windows rolled down, banging Devin, listening to Boo Boo. And I love you, dog. You don't even know what this mean to me to be able to just stand here next to you. And he was like, bro, chill, chill. He was like, bro, chill, chill. And then he got on stage, man, and we opened up for him, and then he got on stage, and it was just like nobody in the room. The tension just left the room. It was like
they read the vibe.
It was like there was never nothing that ever happened before, period. It was like we walked into a whole new club and it was all new faces. But it was the same dudes that I had got into it with, and everybody was hugging and they damn near was kissing each other on the cheek. And I'm not saying that to be like exaggerative. I'm saying that in a figurative.
It was all love there.
Bro, it was crazy as hell. And I seen the control he had over the crowd, and I seen the influence he had, and it just blew my mind because I had never seen that before in an intimate setting. Because I've been to a lot of big shows, but in a more intimate setting, it's a little different when it's a smaller club. Yeah. And all these people is packed in together, and they was finna shoot each other before
just a second
dude
ago.
Got on stage. Yeah. Man, it just made me fall in love with it all the way, and it's just all this shit go along with why I rap the way I do, the bully, all this shit go along with everything, man. I take everything into consideration. I just always been a problem solver type person in my head, man. I just can't help it. I'm just like that.
And that's definitely a good thing to have, because especially when it comes to like stage presence, again, like crowd control is a huge thing that makes all the difference. Especially like if you come into a show where it's like everybody's ready to rip each other's throats off and shit, you know, like if you have control over that, it makes all the difference. Yeah, man. So that's fucking beautiful.
That's the difference between being a rapper and being a real MC.
Yep. The master, was it the master of ceremonies?
Yes, sir.
I've also seen you've linked up with, who was it, K Reno?
K Reno, the first person from Houston to ever show me some love, man. Shout out to K Reno, because that was a very humbling experience. And shout out to Optimo Ram, bro, because he the one that set that all up. He's just my brother, bro. He does the Optimo Ram radio, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
You remember that?
Yeah, okay, throwback. So before podcast was a thing.
Yeah, bro. Nah, it's like, it's crazy, dog. So that was just my genuine real, that was just my friend. Like, he just really, really fucked with me, you know what I'm saying? And I appreciated him for that, because I was going through a lot of shit, and, you know what I'm saying? And he just took me under his wing, bro. And he was like, he called me one day, he's like, hey, man, I'm finna go meet K Reno at, I met him at Starseeds.
Over at Houston?
No, Starseeds. He was in Austin, bro. I met K Reno in Austin at Starseeds, bro.
Damn.
On 35, bro. he met me and Optimo Ram over there. It was the coolest. I ate with him and everything. It was cool as hell, bro. It was the most surreal shit ever, because I'm from Texas and I love Texas, bro. I do what I do on purpose, because I don't want to sound like nothing else, man. And I understand the demographic in Texas, man. So I do my shit on like the way that I do it on purpose. You know what I'm saying? Like, that right there was one of the moments that, like, okay, look, this is, he's, and K Reno told me, he was like, man, you remind me of me, man. I remember, man.
Oh, shit.
And it was just crazy to me to hear him say some shit like that. It was just, I can't even, I don't even have words for that shit, man. Yeah. Just love K, man, I love you, huge. K Reno. It's love, man. It's nothing.
For those that don't know or who aren't familiar with K Reno, he's probably one of the biggest lyrical rappers to come out of Houston, Texas.
Come out of the,
how many albums does this man have now? Like,
bro, I don't even know, bro.
Insane amount of albums, bro. What is he, that South Park Correlation,
them.
Right? SPC?
This dude is one of the most lyrical rappers on earth.
He can rap for days,
The words that he be using, he be fucking me up sometimes. Like, this dude's vocabulary.
Like, you try to predict what he's going to say first.
This dude is the Texas MF Doom.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, and I just thought about that right now as I'm talking.
It makes a lot of sense.
That's the Texas MF Doom, if you really want to be technical.
K Reno definitely.
Yeah, dog.
Go look at his catalog, bro. Man, that's all I'm going to say. Just go look at his catalog.
One word, extensive.
Album after album. Since fucking early 90s is way the fuck back then, bro. Like, goddamn. I fuck with K Reno.
SPC shit, man. And I'm really connected to a lot of the music history out here, man, in Texas, man, and it trips me out a lot, because I'm just now really asking a lot of questions to the people that I came up around, and the answers that I'm getting are fucking wild as fuck. And like, my mom used to be in a group called the Cooley Girls. My mom's on one of Point Blank's albums. Her group mate that she was in, just as 3-2's baby mama.
Oh, damn. This is a small-ass world.
Yeah, bro. Like,
God damn.
It fucked me up.
That is wild. Yeah, that's some history for sure back there.
Yeah, bro.
Man.
And, you ever heard of MC Fatal?
I have not, no.
Man, you from Austin, you need to know who MC Fatal is, because that is one of the founder of the Bloods in Austin.
Damn.
12th Street Bloods, bro. He's one of the founders. Big brother is... man, I'm mad. I can't even think of his big brother name right now, man. I apologize, bro. But man, look, man, dude got history in the city, man. Look, man, dude used to babysit me, bro.
Damn, shit.
That's my uncle, bro.
Damn.
Dude got songs with Bun B and all kind of shit, bro. MC Fatal, go back and look that
MC
shit up,
Fatal,
man.
Yeah, I'm for sure gonna peep that after. Goddamn.
Dude, a staple in the city, man. He need to be on the mural too. He the same past.
Yeah.
He just still alive. He in Atlanta, man. Dude, he used to play for UCLA, though. Dude was at playing UCLA on a full scholarship and was just a street cat and just left that shit alone, man. He just like made his decisions in life and led him on the path that he's on. You know what I'm saying?
Damn.
Yeah, it's definitely. it's a lot of history, man. You sitting here talking all night, we'll be sitting here for 2 hours talking about all the history, how I'm connected to the city, man. It's real deep, man. It's just serious, bro.
Man, I love it. That's what we're here for, man. To fucking learn.
You done
and
gave
teach.
Me this goddamn Corzo. That shit got me lady.
I'm a little upset that it's a little
we
just, out of the.
We're bouncing everywhere, but it is what it's a podcast. This is going on.
But before we go on to anything else, I do want to play one of your songs.
Yes, sir.
From the Stacker Starve album. Man. Which is amazing.
Hey, for the record, hey, for the people that don't believe me, man, hey, I freestyled that whole. Bitch, man, I was that hungry, bro. I wanted it that bad, man. I freestyled the whole motherfucker, bro. Me and Dingus was in that bitch. Shout out, Dingus. You already know what it is, bro. We brothers, we locked in. It's nothing.
He produced that whole album? He
produced the whole album of Stacker Star 1 and 2 and the DoWrong EP. All my first ever projects I ever put out, Dingus. And he's signed to OVO. He's getting... He got a placement on. If you're reading this, it's too late. You go ahead and check that out. He produced Nine Forever, and he's from Austin, man. He's from the South Side, man. And it was crazy. That's why I brought up earlier that without my uncle, a lot of this shit wouldn't have happened.
Uh-huh.
Because my uncle is the reason why I met him. Because when my uncle passed away, the house that we were recording at, I just used to sit in there.
Just chill there.
I just used to sit in there because it was a comforting place to me because that's where we used to go all the time. And the studio was a comforting place to me. That's why I took the rap so serious, you know what I'm saying? So I'm in there every day. And Grizzo and Reggie Kobe, they taught me how to use the computer. So I didn't have to go ask them nothing. I'm sitting there every day, and I know what beats is on here because I'm on this motherfucker every day. I stay there two, 3 weeks at a time. My mama wasn't tripping because she knew how I felt about that place. You know what I'm saying? My mama was always over because my dad passed away when I was young, so she always been like trying to put me in the best schools, trying to put me in the different. I ain't even gonna lie. I wouldn't chose the streets myself. You know what I'm saying? But that's off topic. But you know what I'm saying? And I just used the music and the environment that I was placed in as a coping mechanism, and I was listening to them beats, and I found some and I rapped on them bitches, and I recorded Punch That Bitch. It was the first song I ever recorded on a Dingus beat. Dingus came to the studio probably like the next weekend, and I was there. Just so happened I was there, and he was like, man, it was like, it's another young cat in here. So it was already automatic. We connected because we were the youngest dudes in the room.
Oh, okay.
Because everybody else, you know, they already older. You know, they already did their thing. And you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So when I walked in, just me being me and being the bully's nephew, fam, like, I always had a lot of, I don't even know what to call it. Like, I don't want to call it white privilege. I'm going to call it bully privilege. I'm going to call it bully privilege because my uncle was really, really fucking respected, bro. Like, they really, really, people really still to this day walk up to me and like, man, you bully nephew, you was SB nephew. People that really knew him, man, I remember you. I know who you is, man. And it fucks me up. It just shows how the respect transcends, man. So what my thing was, anytime I wanted to rap, they wouldn't. Grizzo and them didn't really want to let me rap and shit like that. But like, I always was like, I don't give a fuck. I know how to record myself too.
Yeah, you can do it on your own.
I don't care. And then the shit would be so hard, they'd be like, all right,
go do it.
Yeah, we just go through with it.
Shit.
So he was there, and I bullied him out. They were having a whole meeting, and I was like, oh yeah, I just bullied my way to the computer. You know, listen to this. I showed him the shit. It was nothing. He was like, what the? I remember like yesterday because it was just so amazing to me to see somebody reacting to my music that way. It was refreshing. Yeah. He was like, man, that's you? Man, I ain't never heard nobody rap like that on my beats before. Man, it's nothing. We've been friends ever since, bro.
You just clicked up.
We just clicked up, but that's how we met. It was nothing ever since. Man. I start going to his house. We chilling every day, bro. I was staying at his house for like months at a time. We recorded the whole fucking Stack of Star 1 and 2 at the same time. We just never stopped recording. We just kept recording. The Stack of Star 2 is just like, we already had them songs recorded. I recorded like 3 or 4. Going. Yeah, we just kept the shit going. And damn. I was just like, okay, I'm going to call this part 2.
I love that. I mean, yeah, if y'all haven't listened to it, Stack of Star, The American Dream, part 1 and 2. Check that out.
Long-winded as hell.
My actual favorite track on this is All Black, which if you're cool with it, I'm going to play that. Right,
that's
now.
Hard. What's up, Black? What's up, Black?
Nigga, color me red. Red, black, blue, nigga, color me red. Red, black, blue, nigga, color me red. Fuck the red, white, blue, nigga, color me black. Nigga, color me red. Red, black, blue, nigga, color me black. What? Red, black, blue, nigga, color me black. Motherfucker, motherfucker. Fuck the red, white, blue, nigga, color me black. Goddamn. They never give opportunity to the motherfucker that wanna make something out of itself.
Damn.
And they wonder why most never vote on the block, flipping rocks like what else do we got? Damn. So if I got a handshake, we're sending these shots at your top, headed straight to the top, no stopping. The mind of a maniac, America made me that. Product of a place where my mama raised me at. So much crack, make a dope fiend brain relapse. I'm on M talking crazy stacks, that's the American dream. Full speed, all gas supreme. I work that muscle, clock out a block, I work that double. Nigga, you don't know that trouble. My nigga, you don't know my hustle. Baby, on the way, hollin', fuck your struggle. Nigga, color me bad. Red, black, blue, nigga, color me bad.
What the fuck?
Red, black, blue, nigga, color me bad. Fuck the red, white, blue, nigga, color me black.
The more recent shit that I recorded is a... That's crazy, dog.
Nigga, color me bad. Yeah, this is the order. 2016.
Red, black, blue, nigga, color me black.
2016, I had a baby on the way. That's my oldest.
Red,
son,
black, blue, nigga, color me black.
Matter of fact, I don't even know. No.
Fuck the red, white, blue, nigga, color me black.
I had a baby on the way. The baby ended up not being mine.
Oh shit!
So I'm speaking on a baby that ended up not being mine.
Damn.
And then afterwards, I ended up having my own son. So if you go back and listen to Steph, which one is that? I can't even remember, but it's the song I got called "Unborn Son," "Letter to My Unborn Son."
Yeah, that's Stacker's first one.
It's the first one. I'm speaking on a son that ended up. I called it "Unborn Son" because the baby ended up not being mine, and it hurt me. So I'm speaking. In a sense of me talking to my son that's actually gonna be mine in the future.
Fucking music is a time machine.
Shit is crazy, bro.
Man, that was All Black, Stagger Star of the American Dream. We'll be right back after this commercial break.
Talking Texas man energy, organic hemp milk for the remedy.
Yes, we are back. Shout out to the engineers. Shout out to the anybody working behind the scenes, the producers, the videographers, camera folk, anybody who's hooking
shout
it up.
Shout out you too, Zed. I don't give a fuck about that bullshit. You still my nigga, fam. I know you're going to watch this shit.
It's all love.
It's all love, fam.
But yeah, we're back with the bully, with DoWrong, and... Shit, man, you talking about doing some freestyles or what?
Fuck it, you got me out of body, bro, right now, fam. I just got them Corzo, fam. I fuck around and say some shit.
Yeah, I'm about to hit him up for sponsorship, too. Hey, shout out Trudy Oak, though. I fuck with you. I appreciate you. And, yeah, we're still here for you. So.
Shouts out to Corzo.
Oh, man. Yeah, how you feeling about this one?
That's just a given, fam. It is what it is. That shit just, I can hear it in the back of my head. If you got something else, we can do the five finger right now, fam. I'm fucked up, bro. You done gave me this corzo.
Might have to just take you up on that. This is we're starting off with Mobb Deep. Shit, man. Take off whenever you want, man.
Nah, take me an element. Number five, you cannot take me out of element. One beside, never side, step aside, elegant. Yeah, ever forget shit like an elephant. I done told them niggas what before, never said again. If them niggas want it, better break shit. Break it to your front door, ring, nigga, ring. Now I see this shit. I ain't playing game, nigga, seen this shit. Yeah, long route on my long ride, I go door. We ain't playing game, write it down, take a photo. Friday, like Craig, you couldn't do me. Like my name was Red, it said it's Clue Scooby. Yeah, and then life like a movie. We ain't playing game with them niggas, that's how I do things. Yeah, them niggas switching like a mood ring. I show them little niggas I do. You knew me, I ain't playing game, I gotta tell them.
Yeah, look at back.
Quiet. Ring a ladder, you niggas ain't ready for it. For it, I told them niggas don't ready know it. Yeah, ready know it. Yeah, hip hopper, you kangaroo. Told them niggas I rang through when I came and shoot. I ain't playing game with the niggas, you already knew. Huh? I ain't even gotta say it, gotta say it, gotta spread at your head like an aerosol. Nah, you already know I ain't say it all. No, big dog, I bought bike, lock jaw, jaw the dog, give me lock jaw. Damn, them niggas talk, I don't know it all. Don't understand not the language, don't understand. Stained it, hanged it, some niggas brainless, some niggas painless.
What you got?
I got you on the next one. Hold on.
That's some old shit.
Old boy was on here snapping the last time, fam. He made me feel like I need to write something to come to this motherfucker. Boy, whoever that, what's his name? Who came over here and snapped like that, man?
You talking about Clover?
No, not Clover.
You talking about Sed?
Yeah.
Sed? Ted the Legacy and said,
but yeah.
Oh, yeah, bro.
Hey, this is the perfect time. Hey, Ted, hit me up, fam.
Teddy, you hear this, man.
Said hit me up, too. Yeah, it's love, fam. It
it's all
nothing,
work.
Bro. It's all love. It's
y'all are both from different sides, but it's all, you're an alumni, they're an alumni gang. It's two different gangs, but it's all.
It's alumni till I die.
Let's do it. Here, let me see what I got with you.
What you got for me?
I feel like you knocked this bitch off. You give me 50 names and that's it, bro.
Blowing up my phone every day, every night, trying to get it in the light, in the dark. What you write, what you want, either left, either right, and my dex. How I do this shit, test, every checks, get a checks, like a Nike. I just do it, how I flew it, how to fly, let the sky, niggas die. Every day, what you play, never made, Xbox, never play, my station, on the block. What you want, are they bitching, with my phone, what you want, from me, never ask, Tyrese, never me, never cry, on the stage, on the camera, every day, how I get it, never lay, on my back, when I play, never there. Never lay, never let, never day. Every day, I keep it on my lap. When I spray, ever say, never say, he would say, Yeah. What you bitches want from a nigga? What you bitches want from a nigga?
Yeah, I know you be singing too, bro. Yeah, so let him have it.
Yeah, what you bitches want from a nigga? What you bitches want from a nigga? What they want, yeah, what they want, I don't know. Gotta go, let it go, on the floor, from my toe, count it up, every 10, I'm a man, on my 10, understand, I gotta say it, goddamn, I'ma play it, how I play, how I go, niggas know, never ho, up a low, up a floor, niggas know, gotta go,
Hey, yeah, I fuck with that, bro.
I be punching, bro. They don't want me to get in this bitch.
You were just talking about that.
That's how I record, fam. I punch like that. Exactly how I'm doing right now. I keep it going for a little bit. As soon as I don't like it, I stop. I punch again.
Jump back in.
What? That's how I did. That's how I did the whole Beautiful Nightmares too. Y'all gonna see. Who did this?
This is K Rido.
Left to right, boy, I'm ambidex. We ain't playing, go and cut the check. If they wanna go and cut their neck, yeah, I'm at it like a fucking noose. We ain't playing game, never lose. If they want it, I'ma come in two. Yeah, coming twos, one, two, maybe how I do it. Off the floor, baby, by my shoes. If they want it, I'ma go and,
I don't even know what K Reno song this is. Which one is this?
Everything's all right. Hey, I got you in a better one, let me see.
Boy, that boy played the,
Why I Wanna Hate.
Doom, doom. Why y'all wanna hate on a nigga? All I ever do, get the money counted up, they sick to get the death flu. If them motherfuckers want it, we don't show up on it, yeah, I run up on it, with the fucking 44. Who is you? I don't even know fuck who is you, but just who is you? Boy, that hypochondriac, they sick, never seen a shit. I been on my scene and shit for real, on a long ride. If they wanna show them how, yeah, I'ma show them how. Break it down, just like a pine, yeah, yeah. Just like a brick, beat it up off a priest. Yeah, I bitch, I been this shit ever since I was a kid. Yeah, jump up off the porch, black 50 shit, Olympic. Yeah, yeah, I'm the shit. Yeah, yeah, Kokomo. Whoa, you already know. Overdose, this overloads. Whoa, yeah, I'm overtold. Whoa, yeah, this comatose. So all this fucking dope. Whoa, send it to your door. Whoa, send it through this chrome. Whoa, straight up to your dome. Whoa, I don't think you won't. No, I don't think you won't. Whoa, I got what you want. Oh, tell me what you want. Oh, I'ma show you how. Yeah, when I break it down. Yeah, you ain't from around. Yeah, get the fuck from round. Yeah, I ain't seen you round. Yeah, who the fuck is you? You, who the fuck is I? Yeah, I bet your bitch know. Oh, I ain't gotta talk about this shit, they understand. Yeah, ain't no words left my motherfucking lips. Yeah, I been like this, banging like a motherfucking crip. Yeah, yeah, some of my niggas blood. Yeah, they know just what's up. Yeah, I ain't gotta say it. Yeah, ain't gotta bring a flag. Yeah, ain't gotta show it hat. Yeah, yeah, they know it. Yeah.
That's it.
That was our version of the five fingers. Hey, I appreciate you, though, bro. I appreciate you.
Nah, you could have. I ain't gonna care, fam. You can call me on
a. I mean, yeah. let them know, though, what you got coming up, though, because I know you're about to drop. You've been working on dropping. Like, you've been dropping already.
I'm a perfectionist with this shit, man. I don't really do that. I used to do that freestyle and shit like I do all the time, but I don't really. I've been on some
strategic.
On some strategic, saying exactly what needs to be said in the place that it's said. I ain't writing nothing. It's all just organic. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's just like a feel. I can't even explain it, bro. Like, you gotta. I'm gonna just start recording my recording process so motherfuckers can see how I'm doing this. Yeah. So they see. Oh, okay, that's why he doing that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That's why he do it like that, and it all flows together. It all works. You know what I'm saying? So. It is what it is.
What do you have coming out too that everybody can stay tuned and
man, y'all stay tuned. Everybody that's fucking with me, I got for the real fans, man, I got something real special for y'all. I got the DoWrong EP Deluxe version coming out, and I got Beautiful Nightmares 2 coming out, produced by Boz, and I got a little bit of R's on there, and I got a little bit of Beats Era.
Beats Era?
Yeah, dude hit me up on Instagram on some dude got like a million followers, dog.
Oh,
just
shit.
Hit me
just
up.
Fucking and, with you heavy?
Yeah, just fucking with me super tough, dog. He sent me his fucking Dropbox and I just been recording on his beats all week.
Damn, that's live.
So one of his songs made the cut, so I'm finna put that bitch on Beautiful Nightmares.
Y'all stay tuned, let him know what you're
doing. That motherfucker done too, so it's going on and all the socials is at DoWrong, Lil Bully. Like I'm telling you to do wrong, ain't do right. DoWrong, Lil Bully. And just a brief, I didn't come up with that shit. I ain't come up with DoWrong, Lil Bully. This shit was bestowed upon me like a fucking king crown.
You were knighted into
this
shit.
I was knighted into this shit, man. When I was little, Master P had that album out, The Ghetto's Trying to Kill Me, and it's that skit on there, Reverend DoWrong.
Oh, shit. That's where it all comes out of.
That's where DoWrong comes from. And my great-grandma, rest in peace, she used to call me DoWrong. So it's not like
I didn't make this shit up. Yeah. They've been calling me that before I could talk.
Grew up with it.
Yeah, before I could talk, they called me DoWrong. You know what I'm saying? And then the bully passed, and they called me Little Bully. You know what I'm saying? Just naturally, because I'm still keeping this shit going. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I appreciate everybody that's out there fucking with this shit, man. And y'all keep rocking with me, man. We're going to keep this shit going. We're going to get more people onto this shit, and we're going to get this shit going.
Yes, sir. Shit, well, yes, we are at the end of the show, and as I've mentioned prior, we do like to end off on a positive note. Something good, something like you said yourself, like something that they can listen to that's going to be a positive message to them, and that they don't have to worry about, like, stressing about no bad endings and shit like that, even though life comes at you sideways sometimes, you know?
Mental health is not an illness.
No. Take care of those around you. Look out for those around you. Even if you don't hear from your people, check up on them. Just make sure they're straight.
Check up on them, man, because that shit make the world of a difference, man. Love your people while they're here.
Yep.
And you never always know. always stay focused on your goals, man. I don't care what it is. I don't care what's in the way. I don't care. You got to stay true to yourself, man. It's about integrity. It ain't about nothing else. It's about integrity and staying focused and staying committed and staying consistent. And Nipsey Hussle said, man, the difference between me and everybody else, I didn't stop. I ain't stopping for shit, man. Let's go hard or go home, and this shit gonna go. I wouldn't give a damn.
Stack or starve.
Stack or starve, for real, sir. Man. That shit a lifestyle. It ain't just the album name. That shit for real, man. And I appreciate you having me out, bro.
Thank you for coming out, bro. It's all love.
I've been waiting to come, man.
Yeah, I know. We've been fine for a minute, and luckily it all finally happened. And it ain't going to be the last either, so.
Yeah, no. We're going to have some more shit going on. It's going to be another reason. Yeah, hey, man, you had to. Hey, man.
Yeah, no, it's all love. You know, like, we're more than welcome to having people coming over back a lot. So
yeah.
I'm happy you're here. And yeah, I definitely need to. Keep a lookout on DoWrong. Fuck with him. I know he has all his connections to the last generation of the Austin music, but fuck, he's gonna stick and is part of the next generation.
Man, and a lot of these dudes that's out now, I done went to school with them. Jay Soldier, we went to middle school together. Tita, yeah. I've been knowing Tita for years. You know what I'm saying? I've been knowing a lot of these dudes for years.
Yeah.
Cap Lewis was in my math class.
Shit.
I think me and Cap Lewis played football together.
Oh, damn. Yeah, it's a small world out here in Austin. So it definitely is a lot better when we all work together. We all have the same end game, so. One way or another, let's all link up and, you know, fuck with each other. I guess as far as my positive note, it would have to be kind of piggyback on yours, mental health, and, you know, just take care of yourself, too. Look out for your people and take care of yourself. Take those necessary breaks, because I just went on my first vacation in what feels like maybe like 2 or 3 years with my family and my people, and it was definitely, it was fun. It was nice to take a break and be away from everything for a while, so.
Yeah. Self-love is the best love.
Yes, sir. Work as hard as you need to, but don't overwork yourself. Take the necessary breaks and take care of yourself, you know? Look out for yourself just as much. Fucking say no whenever you need to. It's a hard word to hear, but it's also necessary. So look out for yourself and your people. So I appreciate you being here, bro, and I appreciate you coming out. And
glad to come. Anytime you call me, I'm pulling up, man.
Yes, sir.
I know where it's at now. They got lost on them.
I know. It's a mission to get out here.
Everybody that came here, y'all know what it is.
Yeah, we're in uncharted territory, but fuck, we're about to make our territory.
Man.
So,
what the city need, man.
I am Mario from the South Side.
I'm Bully from the North Side, man. What's up, man?
This is
IDK, man.
That's perfect. Yes, sir.
Know.
We're out.
What the fuck? See how far she deep throw the nigga dick. I'm going inside, bitch, I'm outside. Now you see you niggas hitting
run shooting at your back. Cut the check, I just want respect. Mind over matter, matter, I'm a fact. Bitch, if you play with me, I'm a snap. Think about your family, think about your kid. Ain't got shit to lose, say what you talk to me, little bitch. 40 got balls on it with a dick. I'm on the Zen, got a nigga lit. Two cup of the tech, make a nigga itch. I ain't go to sleep, I ain't miss a lick. I'm with your bitch, riding, trying to see how far she deep throw the nigga dick. I'm going inside, bitch, I'm outside. Now you see you niggas hitting lit. Now I ain't see you niggas in the trap. Now I ain't see you nigga with the shit. Hook it that same energy, you see me pussy, bitch, I'm really, really with the shit. Bitch, I be really, really with the shit. Bitch, I be really, really with the shit. Slim, bitch, I be really, really with the shit. Bitch, I demand respect. Bitch, I demand. Same day I met the